a subject which keeps many of you busy, millennial investors. So what are asset managers and new fintech firms doing to attract this new generation?
The offspring of baby boomers are entering their peak earning period and at the same time set to inherit their parents' wealth, creating a $30 trillion market over the next few years.
Sustainable funds, the so-called millennial funds, have launched matching their target audience's values, which happen to be clean, green, ethical and socially responsible. Well, joining us now to look at the rise of the millennial funds is Taeun Kwon. She's the head of wealth manager programs at the Center for Sustainable Finance and Private Wealth at the University of Zurich. Thank you so much for joining us on Sibos TV.
Thank you for having me.
So Taeun, I feel a bit silly asking this, being one myself, but for those of us who are unfamiliar, who exactly are the millennials?
So I think the technical answer is people born between 1981 to 1996 are technically widely accepted as millennials. But I think a more easier intuitive explanation is anyone who uses Instagram or who might be active on Instagram would be considered a millennial.
Okay, so apart from the decade in which they were born, how different is this generation from others?
Actually, I think that's a really interesting question because I've heard arguments saying that, yes, you know, baby boomers were also once protesting in 1968. They've been to Woodstocks. Are they really that different from, I don't know, us hanging out in Coachella? So I've heard these arguments before, but when you actually look into research, they are quite different. They're more racially diverse. They're more educated, generally also poorer in comparison to the same age group decades before. We also have a tendency to marry later. So these are all demographic changes that that would symbolize millennials. But I think a more interesting part is that we consume differently. So we, instead of ownership, we're part of the sharing economy. We have different value systems. I think every employer has complained that millennial employees are the worst. So there's definitely something different. And I think a big topic is definitely sustainability.
Another one of those differences, possibly. Do millennials favor socially responsible investing more than the previous generation, do you think?
So there was a survey that's quoted again over and over done by JP Morgan that says millennials are interested, 86% have said they're interested in investing sustainably in comparison to the average, which was only 75%. So I could say yes, but I don't think there's any new discovery. Anybody who has met a millennial will probably say this is not news.
And in terms of the funds, which are supposedly geared towards this group, ESG funds against green funds, impact funds, etc. I mean, what are they?
Yes, that's the old war of terminology. It gets very, very overwhelming because when you think of sustainability, you quickly understand it's a complex topic. It's very layered. When you think, for instance, of saying, oh, I'm eating healthy, for instance, there are many different ways how you can eat healthy. You can skip, I don't know, alcohol. You can skip red meat. You can say, I only eat organic food, organic meat. So there are different ways. Same with sustainable investing. There are different ways how you can invest sustainably. And with that come all these terminologies like green funds, ESG funds, impact funds that all have a slightly different approach of doing sustainable investing. Should I go a little bit into the...
Yeah, please, okay. Do.
So ESG funds are funds that integrate ESG, so environmental, social, and governance factor into their investment process. It just means that instead of looking just at the financial statement of companies, they also consider, oh, is the company contributing or harming the environment, and then make their decisions accordingly. Green funds are just funds that have some sort of environmental affinity to their investment process. Impact funds, on the other hand, are quite a bit more interesting because these are funds who intentionally want to create impact. So they have a different intention than just pure financial return. And oftentimes they refer to more private market products like venture capitals or private equity funds.
Okay, so there's quite a bit for them to choose from in that regard.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Are there any standards to define what constitutes responsible investing?
So for a long time, there weren't. It was more of about defining it and getting the terminology clarified and then maybe classifying all the different approaches so that people can have a framework to understand. And this was done by the Global Sustainable Investing Alliance with help of local players and so on and so forth. But what's really interesting right now is, of course, the regulatory side. There's an EU action plan coming up. It's being implemented actually as we are speaking right now. And they are, part of their 10 actions is actually creating a standard for terminology and labeling. So there's that.
Mm. And what's going to drive up ESG and impact investing? Is it going to be regulation or actual demand, given that it's pretty specific to a group who we assume are clued in to what's going on around the world?
So it's going to be a bit of both. When we look into the previous markets that have integrated sustainability, when we look into the bio market, organic market, or the war on plastic, it's not just the regulatory side or it's not just the demand side, it's the reaction and interaction of both. So for sustainable investing, there's definitely going to be the regulatory push, at least on this side of the continent, where the EU action plan is implementing, for instance, to disclose more sustainability relevant risk information on the fund fact sheets, for instance, or if you as a customer enter the bank, then the bank is obliged to ask you, oh, do you have a ESG, environmental social governance preference? And this will naturally then lead to more people reflecting on it, with millennials, with more women who are also more interested. They will just start saying yes. So then again, the demand caters back into the markets.
Now, I expect your answer to this question might depend on your perception of what the end actually is. Mm-hmm. But in the end, which funds do you think will win the race? Those with solid track return records are those that show greener, more sustainable investing.
So sorry to say this, but I feel like this is a bit of a silly question because immediately it means that you have to choose between either or, and these things are not mutually exclusive. So you can still have financially superior return while still investing sustainably. I think a better way to think about it is, okay, how much or how far do you want to implement sustainability factors into your investment thesis? But I don't think it's a question of choosing. And if anybody knows millennials, we are entitled and greedy. So I think in the end...
Surely not.
I think in the end, those funds that manage to do both very well are going to be the winners.
And there are millennials for whom sustainable investing, it's all about saving the world. But do they really do that? I mean, does it have any impact in that sense?
So I think that's a really, really great question, because when we talk about sustainable investing, everybody talks about with the investing side. And I'm always asked the question, oh, is the financial return the same? Is there a financial trade-off? And in academia, there are more than 2,200 papers saying there is no trade-off. So this is a well-researched question, closed case. And nobody's asking the question on, okay, but does it have anything, any kind of impact? And I think, especially for Sibos, what's more important to keep in mind is that because the topic is more on securities, it's a secondary market. So if you sell and buy funds, and if it's just about that financial transaction, it has no influence on the company's practice, which is what actually sustainable investing is trying to achieve. You want to, through your financial transaction, have the company change their behavior in a sustainable way. If you're simply buying and selling stocks, then the neighbor idiot will come and buy off the shares of British Tobacco off your hands. So there is no influence, they don't care. What has an influence is actually active ownership. So if you own the share, you also need to exercise your shareholder rights, and that's the only way how you can actually create impact in securities trading.
Well, from one millennial to another, Taeun, it's been fascinating speaking to you. We shall release you back into Sibos 2019. Taeun Kwon, the head of wealth management programs at the Center for Sustainable Finance and Private Wealth at the University of Zurich. Thank you very much for joining us on Sibos TV.
Thank you.